Hello, everyone. My name is Fantix. As Colin mentioned, I'm a software engineer at EdgeDB, but I'm usually known as being too obsessed with diagrams. So I'll mostly talk about the architecture of EdgeDB today with some real diagrams. So you are warned here. Just a quick disclaimer, in the Discord channel, I think people mentioned Gino. And yes, it is an ORM library I built. But its full name is actually Gino is not ORM because I really hated ORMs in general. All right, getting back to the talk. On 30,000 feet above, HDB itself is actually pretty easy, the architecture. Here you have a client. You define a schema as demonstrated previously. And you issues a bunch of SQL queries to HDB. On HDB side, it compiles your SQL queries into SQL queries and execute them in the Postgres cluster. In this cluster, we store all the data, including the user data, as well as a bunch of built-in data like the built-in schema, data types, standard library roles, configurations. All that is needed to run a proper HDB instance. HDB usually comes with a bundled Postgres, so this whole thing is encapsulated and you have no fear of the Postgres cluster in most of the cases. But in the following diagrams, I'll show them separately so that I can see actually the interaction between them. In this chart, we can see more internals about HDB server. The server itself is written in Python. We also build a lot of Python and Rust extensions to make the critical parts really run fast. HDB server uses UVLOOP to handle all the I/O on the network and uses a subprocess pool to compile the SQL queries. The compiled SQLs are stored in an in-memory cache as well as the prepared statement from the Postgres. So that when the same query, when the same SQL query is issued again and again to the server, it will just try to load the cache and run the execution directly. Like async PG, HDB server is also using the Postgres native binary protocol to talk to Postgres in a very fast way, because we, as in the middle layer, knows all what we need to do with the backend Postgres. We did a lot of optimizations on the network, is like pipelining, so that literally every, like Yuri mentioned at the beginning, every SQL query only issues one network packet to not only the HDB server, but also to the Postgres, and it returns the result. Similarly, between HDB server and the client, we designed a binary protocol for the communication, and this is intentionally inheriting the same binary data format as the Postgres binary protocol does, so that the HDB server itself will don't have to do any unpacking or reserialization of the actual data. So altogether, it looks like this. The client issues a SQL query. When the server is fully heated, it just loaded all the cache and run the query directly in the Postgres cluster, and it returns the binary result with the Postgres headers. We parse the headers and don't touch the binary data, and we wrap it with the HDB headers, types, and et cetera, and just send it over back to the wire. So everything is just fast and simple. We're literally talking about microseconds of latency added by the HDB server itself. When it comes to a more realistic production environment, things becomes much more interesting with more clients. They're having more connections to the HDB server, and these connections all share the same cache we mentioned earlier, as well as a Postgres connection pool here. That literally means the connection between clients and the HDB server is super lightweight, and completely stateless after authentication. So, also because HTTP server is driven by UV loop, we can easily scale this, the number of client connections to tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of connections, because those connections will only acquire a Postgres connection from the pool when they're issuing a query, and they will return it back to the pool as soon as they finish the query. The same thing applies to transactions, but during the transaction, the Postgres connection will be pinged to the client connection, and likewise, they're returned as soon as they are the transaction finishes. This is very likely to be the PG bouncer mode. In this case, you can just use a single HTTP server without any other abstraction layers to make your application happy. You might also have noticed the two databases here and our two groups of clients. This corresponds to the concept in Postgres where you could have multiple databases in the single Postgres cluster. And HTTP supports the same concept, only that we added more optimizations to this model because HTTP server actually knows what every each client here tries to do with the data. We can, that makes us able to implement a rather complex algorithm in the Postgres connection pool so that we can balance between the different pressures from different clients so that none of those quiet clients will be waiting for a connection for too long time while the other group is busy with the very frequent queries. Okay, that is what we did to the server side quality of the service. Now let's switch gear a little bit to the front end, the client side. When you are building your application, you are usually dealing with the real world, which is full of unreliable factors, like you might have the cloud, you might have HTTP server in a Docker image, Docker container, you might have a virtual network in between them. Anything that might go wrong will eventually go wrong, Murphy's Law. So usually your application is taking care of all those network or unexpected events. But in this case, HTTP official client libraries is taking care of part of the issues for you. Like we're automatically retrying to establish the connection under your configurable retry policies. Once the connection is established, the HTTP binary protocol is also defining a hierarchy of errors. Part of them is the retryable error that is defined in the HTTP server side to reflect errors like a transaction isolation level serialization error, or it's simply the Postgres cluster is temporarily unavailable because AWS is doing some failover on it. In this case, as HTTP server, we know exactly what happened. We know it's safe to retry, so we propagate this retryable error to the client library, and it will just retry it for you. Same thing for network errors, only that we're doing on read-only errors, and we know that from a two-phase interaction between the server, and in which we also cached it to make the round trips a minimum, because on the second time there will be only one optimistic query. I won't get too deep into this, but I would also like to mention when this whole retry logic comes to transactions, it becomes more verbose. As you can see here, this is a snippet of Python code. This is the same transaction in JavaScript. The HTTP client libraries are enforcing using this kind of for grammar the users to think about the transactions, because we think that is the right thing to do when the transaction is facing some retryable errors. You should simply retry the whole transaction block instead of just a single query. And in this case, from grammar level, you as a developer will think, what should I include in this transaction when it is retried? This is, yeah, what we did for the overall quality of service on the client side. From a different perspective view, HDB itself is not just a server. As we mentioned multiple times, we are building the same retry logic and quality of service into several different client libraries so that you will have the consistent developer experience using different languages. HDB itself runs on different backend Postgres clusters, and we especially have a CLI command line tool you have already seen previously. We're super proud of it. It delivers the same developer experience and conventions and workflows on your favorite development platforms. Our website is maintaining tons of learning resources. And for the quality assurance and the continuous delivery, we're automating everything on our development, on the core development. We have thousands of automated tests running on about 100 different combos of environments. We're automatically releasing to about 60 different targets that you are downloading and installing on the client. And in the future, for production usage, we have this upcoming HDB cloud, which I won't spoil too much in my talk here. All right, I think that's all I wanted to share here. Thank you very much.